This is Brazil, a land teeming with natural beauty and abundant resources, a powerhouse in agricultural production. Now, on to Japan, a nation known for technological innovation and precision engineering. Meet Carla, a Brazilian farmer who grows coffee, and Hiroshi, a Japanese engineer who designs cars. Their lives seem worlds apart, but they're connected by trade. Carla's farm flourishes in Brazil's perfect coffee-growing climate, while Hiroshi's company thrives in Japan's tech-savvy environment. They both use their country's strengths to succeed. Remember Uncle Vito's pizza palace? Just like Vito found his niche in pizza, Brazil excels in agriculture and Japan in technology. In our last lesson, we talked about how scarcity means that each country has to make decisions about how to use the resources that it has. And it should make those choices based on its comparative advantage. Do you remember what comparative advantage is? Comparative advantage is the ability of a firm or country to produce a good or service at a lower opportunity cost than other goods or services. If you need a refresher on how to calculate comparative advantage, feel free to pause and revisit the lesson from Unit 2. Now, let's see how Carla and Hiroshi's countries decide between coffee and cars. Brazil can produce either 200,000 cars or 2 million bags of coffee. Japan can make 500,000 cars or 1 million bags of coffee. Which should each country focus on? Take a moment to calculate each country's opportunity costs, and we'll take a look together. Okay, here are the results for both countries and both products. Japan can produce cars with a lower opportunity cost compared to Brazil. For Brazil, it's coffee. In other words, Japan has the comparative advantage in producing cars, and Brazil has it for coffee. In this scenario, even though each country could choose to produce some cars and some coffee, they are more likely to specialize in the product for which they have that comparative advantage. Let's take a moment to check in. Your friend thinks that countries should only import products they cannot produce themselves. How could you explain to them why a country might want to import a product it can produce locally? You might explain that countries might want to import products when they have a comparative advantage in other industries. Now, how does the choice of Japan and Brazil to focus on their comparative advantage affect their trade? This brings us to an essential concept in international economics, the balance of trade. Balance of trade is a key indicator of a country's economic health in relation to other nations. But how does the specialization we just talked about influence a country's balance of trade? The balance of trade is quite simply the value of a country's exports minus the value of their imports. The balance of trade can be favorable, meaning that the value of exports is greater than the value of imports, or unfavorable, meaning that the imports are greater than exports. A favorable trade balance is called a trade surplus. Basically, the country is taking in more money from exports than it is paying out to other countries for imports. An unfavorable trade balance is called a trade deficit. That means the country is in essence losing money to other countries through trade because the value of imports exceeds exports. What factors can affect a country's balance of trade and its importance to a country's economy? One factor is the degree of industrialization within a country. For industrialized countries, exports often include high-revenue goods like cars or electronics. There is generally high demand for these goods, so these countries might end up with a surplus in their balance of trade. In contrast, developing countries often export farm products or simple manufactured goods. These products tend to generate less revenue and can be affected more by changes in world markets or the weather, making their earnings and balance of trade less stable and more prone to deficit. Another key factor is the diversity of a country's exports. Imagine a country that mostly exports agricultural products and not much else. If there's a bad drought, it really hurts their overall balance of trade. But countries that sell lots of different goods are much less impacted by shifts in international trade within one industry. Historically speaking, many countries that were former colonies during the age of imperialism were forced to develop less industrialized and less diverse economies to serve as a resource to imperialist countries in Europe and North America. They were forced to be economically dependent. Since gaining their independence, many of these countries still export primarily raw materials and agricultural products, so they often find themselves in trade deficits due to the lower value of these exports compared to the higher value of imported manufactured goods. Based on what you've learned so far, how much do you think it matters whether a country has a trade surplus or a trade deficit? Pause for a moment and record your thoughts. So, how much does it matter if a country has a trade surplus or a trade deficit? Well, a trade surplus can have positive effects on a nation's economy. Let's zoom in on the car industry again. It's a great example because it involves complex manufacturing, global supply chains, and large-scale employment. In countries like Germany and Japan, car exports contribute to a trade surplus, which boosts their overall employment and GDP. Countries with surpluses are generally seen as more stable economically, which can attract foreign investment. And all this economic strength can create a cycle that reinforces this strength. With increased earnings from exports, governments and businesses in surplus countries have more capital to invest in infrastructure, technology, and training, which creates stronger, more diverse industries and generates more exports. What about a trade deficit? Well, sustained trade deficits can lead to increased national debt and affect the value of a country's currency. These challenges can worsen economic dependence and prevent the development of a diverse, self-sustaining economy. And trade deficits can also have big political and social implications. In the long term, countries with trade deficits can become vulnerable to foreign political influence and face high rates of unemployment or social unrest. Is a trade deficit always bad? Not necessarily. It's important to consider the context, including how long the deficit has been in place and the reasons for it. And as always, it's important to consider the balance of trade as just one of many economic indicators, including GDP, employment, and so on. Take a moment to revise your earlier answer. Thank you. take a minute to recap. Countries generally choose to specialize in those products and industries in which they have a comparative advantage. This specialization affects each country's balance of trade, or the difference in value between a country's exports and imports. The balance between a country's exports and imports can be influenced by the country's level of industrialization and the diversity of its exports. And this balance of trade can affect a country's employment levels, GDP, national debt, and currency value, along with potential political and social implications. But it's just one of many economic indicators to consider. So we've seen how countries like Brazil and Japan use their strengths to shape their economies. Next time, we'll explore how trade barriers can affect this delicate balance. Until next time, this is Bea, reminding you to keep investing in your future, one lesson at a time. See you next time. Hey, hey.